thank you all for coming, and most of all, I'd like to thank also Jean-Louis Romanet for coordinating this opportunity today to have Professor Mohammad-Mahmoud Ould Mohamedou from Geneva. You've all seen his CV, there's no need to repeat the details, but it is not a, I mean, and the size of the audience will testify that he is the foremost expert on issues like political violence and Al-Qaeda and state building, and he teaches in many places, including Geneva and Paris, and he's not a stranger to Cambridge. You've been here, your children were born here, I understand. So Professor Mohamedou will speak for about half an hour, and then we will have some questions and a discussion. And this is being filmed, it's going on YouTube, so greetings to people watching it as well. Thank you.
Shukran. Thank you very much, and good afternoon, everyone. It's a real pleasure to be here. Thank you for taking the time to join us. Let me thank Nadim for his kind welcome. Thank you very much, Jean-Louis. It's a pleasure to be here with you this afternoon and discussing some of these issues that have shot at the top of world affairs, and to shed some lights on them. There's a lot to cover, so I'll get going. What I'd like to discuss with you this afternoon is to try to put in perspective this issue of the rise and development of what is referred to as the Islamic State, but also trying to get this from a perspective where we look historically to the actual meaning above and beyond the journalistic narrative, or the policy one for that matter, and approaching this very much from a social sciences perspective, trying to highlight some issues that I would like to put forward. So I'm going to present three propositions this afternoon. The first is that to understand Al-Dawla al-Islamiyya fil Iraq wa al-Sham, Daesh, the Islamic State, Islamic State in Iraq and Syria. I will use ISIS for shorthand purposes, although the name is officially now shortened to the Islamic State. To understand it, we have to understand Al-Qaeda, its emergence and its evolution. The second argument is that Al-Dawla al-Islamiyya itself, the Islamic State, is proceeding at this stage in innovative yet contradictory ways. And I'll unpack this a little bit. Thirdly, and probably what I really would like to get across this afternoon to you and hopefully discuss, is that above and beyond the trajectories of these two groups, Al-Qaeda in the 90s and 2000s and ISIS in the 2010s, this trajectory is revealing a deficit in the social sciences conceptualization of our contemporary second decade of the early 21st century already, understanding of political violence. Now I'll explain that further down the road. So, to understand ISIS, we have to understand Al-Qaeda. And the starting point is 1979. Not the Iranian Revolution, which for many started the Islamist wave, but rather December 1979, the Soviet Union's invasion of Afghanistan. Al-Qaeda's precise lineage, paradoxically, in spite of the wealth of works on it, is not fully documented, we should say, but concordant sources allow us to place it in early 1983. In Afghanistan as a liaison office for fighters on their way to the Soviet-Afghan front. Set up by a Palestinian school teacher, Abdullah Azam, this office was known as Maktab al-Khadamat lil-Mujahideen, the Office of Works for Combatants. Azam was then joined by an Egyptian surgeon, Ayman al-Dawahiri, who had been arrested in jail during the purges of Egyptian Islamists following the assassination of President Anwar al-Sadat in 1981, and later a Saudi millionaire, Osama bin Laden. In late 1989, building on the momentum of the Soviet retreat, inevitably, but not inaccurately, depicted by the fighters as a victory, for which it had received US support, to put at rest the conspiratorial mindset, the Troika, Azam, Al-Dawahiri, and Bin Laden, turned this office of works into a full-fledged armed militancy organization with the explicit goal of deploying a transnational form of radical Islamism meant to transcend borders and attack the enemies of Islam on their territory. This innovative leitmotif would come to pass in Al-Qaeda's phraseology as a strategic shift from the near enemy, Al-Adu Al-Qarib, to the far enemy, Al-Adu Al-Ba'id. So the revolutionary, therefore, rather than evolutionary nature of what Al-Qaeda was bringing in terms of the history of political violence, must be stressed for us in the following manner. First, a logic of displacement. Up until then, Islamism was a regional dynamic. All terrorism had also been local, concerned with the immediate place as such. Secondly, a global perspective, taking the battle from one global superpower to the other. And thirdly, capitalization on modern technology. Finally, and most importantly, a martial nature. This last aspect, which very much connects with the ISIS story now, warrants highlighting, namely the military context and outlook of Al-Qaeda. In the early texts, in fact, you will find the group referring to itself as Al-Jaysh al-Islami, the Islamic army, or Sajil al-Qaeda, the registry of the base, or even Al-Qaeda al-Askariya, the military base. In other words, the novelty of Al-Qaeda, which ISIS will come to fully unpack subsequently and in their own way, is the result of a coincidence of an explicit decision on the part of the group of Islamist militants to project their use of political violence globally and the materialization of empowering patterns of globalization. And I think this, to capture it further, this is exactly the point about Al-Qaeda, which I would submit to you is as much the child of globalization as it is the product of religious radicalism. And what Al-Qaeda does is essentially two things, transnationalizing terrorism and militarizing Islamism. This, in effect, is the contribution of Al-Qaeda to this political violence story. It does this, and this is equally important for ISIS now, while being born in war. That is, not political struggle or economic despair, and with a sense, thirdly, of strength as such, a perception of victory over the Soviet Union. Of course, the Soviet Union lost this conflict in Afghanistan as much because of its strategic mistakes and because asymmetrical wars are unwinnable for the military, but the sense that Al-Qaeda had that it defeated it is equally consequential. So Al-Qaeda was born in war and a perception of victory, and this gave it a powerful anchor as such. Another genealogical feature of Al-Qaeda which needs to be highlighted and is particularly important is that for all of the discourse about the Middle East and North African dimension of this story, Al-Qaeda is in effect just as much, if not more, an Asian story rather than an Arab one. The group is formed at a meeting in Khost, Afghanistan in August 1989, roughly, and bin Laden dies in Abbottabad, Pakistan in May 2011. In between, the group battles, the main story for it, the US and the UK, in Afghanistan, notably in 2001-2002. What follows in the 1980s and the early 1990s formative period then is the heyday of Al-Qaeda, as we have come to know it, and an era which is already a bygone one, an evanescence accelerated by the rise of ISIS. From about 95 to 2005, some 10 years, Al-Qaeda takes world center stage. It declares war on the United States, not once, but twice, in August 96 and February 98. Leads five transnational operations, honing its skills, particularly the modus operandi of simultaneous operations, twice in Saudi Arabia, Kenya, Tanzania, Yemen, culminating the sequence in the September 11 attacks. 9/11, the ultimate postmodern transnational terrorism event, a two-hour operation on four cities in the east coast of the United States, designed in Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia, rehearsed in Tarragona, Spain, financed from Abu Dhabi in the United Arab Emirates, and led by a five-nationality 19-man commando assembled in Hamburg, Germany, and trained in Kandahar, Afghanistan. Clearly something here about globalization facilitating this, as I was saying earlier. In the face of advancing troop hunting for its leadership in 2001 and 2 and offsetting its planning, Al-Qaeda unpacks further this element by welcoming two things. First of all, disseminating its attacks around the world, a series of 11 attacks we should remember, Djerba, Tunisia, Karachi, Bali, Mombasa, Kenya, Riyadh, Casablanca, Jakarta, Istanbul, Madrid, and London. And it closes the sequence, secondly, by creating five branches around the world, the so-called franchises, as we have come to term them, particularly the one in the between Saudi Arabia and then Yemen, Al-Qaeda and the Arabian Peninsula, in Europe, an organization known as the Secret Organization of Al-Qaeda in Europe, which claims the Madrid and the London attacks. A little known, or rather short-lived, Al-Qaeda in Egypt, which was announced at the time. And of course, the entity in Afghanistan and Pakistan, and Al-Qaeda fi bilad al-Rafidain, which is the Al-Qaeda in the land of the two rivers in Mesopotamia, in Iraq as such. In addition to this, and upon the request of an Algerian organization known as the Salafist Group for Predication and Comeback, it builds in its cosmogony a third tier of organizations attracted to it. In particular, three groups: the Shabab in Somalia, Boko Haram in Nigeria, and a short-lived Lebanese Fatah al-Islam, which is the matrix, in fact, the embryo of what we have today emerging as the groups, the jihadi groups in the Levant. The franchise element is particularly important and constituted a second innovation in commodifying, bottling, as the marketers would say, its recognizable brand. Al-Qaeda was McDonaldizing, in effect, in this way, this activity. Not so much engaging in PR, but more importantly, generating self-sustaining impact while lessening the pressure on the central organization in Pakistan and Afghanistan, which was, of course, being hunted, pursued by the United States in the biggest manhunt in history, of course, 10 years for bin Laden, and up until now for the Dawahiri, we should remember. Yet, I would argue to you, ladies and gentlemen, this came at a price. Because precisely in doing this, Al-Qaeda was losing control of the direction of what initially bin Laden and the Dawahiri had in mind. Now, what does this pre-ISIS Al-Qaeda trajectory reveals for us? Firstly, that Al-Qaeda grew in importance because it had been able to remain proactive and strategic, including adaptation. Post 9/11 large-scale counterterrorism, the biggest in history, most earlier groups had been eminently reactive, particularly terrorist groups of the 1970s and the 80s and before that. Secondly, it was substantially resilient for some 20 years, 1989 to 2010, which gave it time to grow organically. And thirdly, as noted, for all intents and purposes, that Al-Qaeda is a thing of the past. It is gone. In embracing globalization, evanescence, and franchising, Al-Qaeda had arguably reached the limits of what transnational terrorism could offer as such. From there on, we enter a new period, the current period, in which three things happen. One is the gradual emancipation and by now full independence of these franchises: AQIM, AQAP, and of course AQI, Al-Qaeda in Iraq, which is today ISIS. Two, the materialization of a steady pattern of Al-Qaeda-inspired individualized and privatized terrorism, born in the wake of this legacy of 10 years of Al-Qaeda, and not necessarily in line with Al-Qaeda's ideas, from Richard Reid to the Kawashi brothers recently, by way of Mohammed Mera, Anders Breivik, the Tsarnaev brothers, what has been, I think, misleadingly referred to as lone wolves. They hardly are, in fact, completely alone when they conduct these operations. Thirdly, the return to regionalism, with an increasing greater attention by Al-Qaeda's operators to the local issues. So AQIM concerned with the Sahel, AQI concerned with Iraq and the Levant, and AQAP concerned with increasingly the situation in Saudi Arabia and then Yemen. It is in this context that ISIS is born. I turn now to the second pillar of my discussion. The logic pursued by Al-Qaeda with its mid-2000 franchise is one of multiplying, as I said, these startups, sometimes failing in Egypt, as we saw. And even in October 2006, there was an announcement of Al-Qaeda in Palestine, which was equally short-lived. But with the view to deepen a security vortex gone global, in the middle of which stood this Al-Qaeda al-Umm, as I termed it in my book, Understanding Al-Qaeda, the mother Al-Qaeda entity, referred to as Al-Qaeda headquarters or central. But it resulted, however, in enabling the rise of middle managers, something very much seen in globalization patterns. And you see individuals increasingly in control of their provinces. Anwar al-Awlaqi in Yemen, Adam Gaddan in Afghanistan, Abdel Malik Droukdel in Algeria, and of course, most visibly, Abu Mus'ab al-Zarqawi in Iraq. Gradually, we see the franchises doing two things. One, they are increasingly acting on their own without necessarily referring nor informing, for that matter, Al-Qaeda Central. This was vividly illustrated, if you recall, by the episode in which a Zarqawi in Iraq was scolded by bin Laden through al-Dawahiri for targeting the Shia. He had received a letter telling him that this is not acceptable, that this is not in line with the strategy. Secondly, and as a sign of things to come, the franchises become increasingly immersed with the local issues, in effect going into a Lord of the Rings type voyage of from the near to the far enemy and back. And you see this concern, in effect, contradicting precisely what bin Laden had in mind. Secondly, we see an atomization. And as the Iraq, North African, and Gulf franchises turn out to be threats on their own, they cumulatively lead the central organization down. Underwriting this process is also the emergence of a new generation, 20 years. So kids in 1989, teenagers around 9/11, by the 2010s, these actors are essentially a war generation, particularly in Iraq. And if we build for that the 10 years of the Iran-Iraq war, clearly all of the experience had been marshaled, militarized, and growing up in such an environment is consequential. So in the final analysis, what could be read as a regionalization of Al-Qaeda ended up confusing the global picture for the organization. The elasticity the group has sought creatively, innovatively, to adopt partly voluntarily, but partly in reaction to counter-terrorism measures, as I said, ended up creating an ever-growing distance between the organization and these already independent units. The death of bin Laden and his emerging, his Che Guevarization, shall we say, as the historical figure of the groups and the inability of the Zawahiri to replace him as an authoritative, charismatic, and consensual leader closed that chapter, probably for good. And so the natural subsequent development becomes the hybridization of Al-Qaeda. And that lull moment, and I insist on that, between 2011, May 2011, to what takes place in 2013 is a key moment where there's indecision about what's happening and uncertainty. That this is the time when many authors are telling us that Al-Qaeda is defeated, is gone, is dead, just precisely at the same time that it's going to be reborn, probably more powerful than ever. Thus, an interesting comment about prediction here. But that development, I think, is also had to do particularly with the deft use of information technology that Al-Qaeda introduced. It's quite common these days to talk about how good ISIS is about using technology, and I have a few things to say in a moment about this. But let us recall that that is also an innovation that Al-Qaeda itself introduces. If you compare that to previous types of terrorism, it's completely innovative, from the videos that are being sent, to the use on the media, to documentary that are uploaded at the time. A lot of innovation is introduced at that time, and this media savviness is precisely what the new generation has plenty of, the use of the video games generation as such. And so at the end of this road, and having mastered transnational impact and digital versatility, Al-Qaeda found itself doing two things it had avoided doing so far. One, being reactive to other initiatives, and secondly, being concerned with eminently local developments. This is precisely what is being ushered by ISIS. I submit to you, ladies and gentlemen, that we are witnessing a sort of rebirth of Al-Qaeda al-Umm through a franchise that grew independent, yet towards qualitatively different aims. The documentary ISIS story goes like this. It's a bit complicated and might be familiar to you, so please bear with me here. In mid-1999, Abu Mus'ab al-Zarqawi, a Jordanian, comes back from Afghanistan and sets up his own organization independently from Al-Qaeda, Jama'at al-Tawheed wa-Jihad, the group of unity and jihad. In 2003, he starts operation in Iraq before Al-Qaeda. And the two founding bombings, you might recall, of the Jordanian embassy and the UN in August 2003 were his. In October 2004 of the following year, he pledges allegiance to bin Laden and turns his group, Jama'at al-Tawheed, or Jihad, into Al-Qaeda in Iraq. Upon his death, which comes quite rapidly, June 2006, he is replaced by Abu Omar al-Baghdadi, not to be confused with Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi, and who changes the group as early as October 2006 into the Islamic State in Iraq. In other words, the current discussion that we pick up last June about ISIS and the reification of it as this entity is quite, in fact, amnesic of what we have seen, which starts in October 2006 as such. And from that moment, the replacement of a Zarqawi places the trajectory of this group into very much an Iraqi story. Then Abu Hamza al-Muhajir, and then Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi, and they capitalize particularly on the Syrian conflict in 2011, and announce in May of last year the creation of the Islamic State in Iraq and Syria, Dawla al-Islamiyya fi al-Iraq wa al-Sham, this is what they add, in effect adding Syria to their dominion, initially through a failed association with Jabhat al-Nusra. But this is immediately opposed by the Wahiri, who seeks to no avail to cancel the merger and the group's ambition. That event is particularly important, and we have to stress it. The fact that the Wahiri the very next day says, we haven't authorized this, you shouldn't do it, this is unacceptable, is the very first time that you have public dissonance in the message of Al-Qaeda. Up until then, communication has been perfectly controlled, and everybody was in line. And it's not surprising. The death of bin Laden, as I was saying, opens that. But the inability of the Wahiri to control, and having al-Baghdadi, in effect, saying, it's fine, we're going to go ahead anyway, we heard you, but we don't care. And by the way, we're not just the Islamic State, we're the Islamic Caliphate. And I'm Khalif Ibrahim. So it's kind of a, it's risible for to many Muslims around the world, but the statement itself is actually kind of a power-generating statement as such. By doing that, he transcends not only the organization, but goes on onto another level. And of course, this is June 29 of last year. The manner in which Al-Qaeda reacts is indicative of its falling star. In September of last year, Al-Qaeda creates what? A new franchise, Al-Qaeda in India. In effect, doing more of the same. They're passé, they're not able to address this. This is where we are today. Namely, a fast-moving landscape, repetitive, but in fact indicative of an evolving scene in which ISIS shares a certain DNA with Al-Qaeda, but is writing its own story, which is only beginning. What do they have in terms of similarities? Because there's a few. First of all, and most importantly for me, a context of a lengthy armed conflict born of occupation and domestic strife. If you think about it, Afghanistan from 1979 to 1989, Iraq since 2003, Syria since 2011. ISIS is also born in war, just like Al-Qaeda. Secondly, a globally expanding transnational militant front in the 80s and today the 50-plus nationalities in ISIS. Thirdly, the complex tapestry of superpower involvement, USSR and US then, US and Russia today. Fourthly, competing powerful regional actors with colliding agendas, Pakistan, Afghanistan then, now Iran, Saudi Arabia, to which one can add Turkey, Qatar, and the United Arab Emirates. Fifthly, shadowy proxy war dynamics. ISI, that is the Pakistani intelligence service, and the Mujahideen then, Hezbollah, Al-Quds, many other actors today. Sixthly, powerful local insurgencies. The Northern Alliance then, all manners of group today in both Syria, Harakat al-Harar al-Sham, Jaysh al-Mujahirin, the militias in Iraq, the Shiite militias and Sunni groups in Iraq. And finally, very important, sporadic tactical victories by the group cumulatively generating strategic momentum. And that's how we see the Arab Afghans then, ISIS soldiery today. A battle-hardened generation in both senses. But there are differences between Al-Qaeda and ISIS, and they are important. I see three key ones I'd like to highlight for our discussion. First, ISIS is immersed, and this is really the point I'd like to highlight, in a territorially defined struggle. A romanticized Levant or Sham, which is real to many militants, but which never really existed administratively, whereas the original Al-Qaeda was eminently about transcending boundaries, as we said it, the far enemy. Secondly, the ideology, in fact, ISIS has an address. It's the Islamic State in Iraq and in Syria, as opposed to Al-Qaeda, the basis of the struggle globally as such. Secondly, the ideological component of ISIS is thin and ranks secondarily to its identity, Levantine and confessional, Sunni. Dimensions when bin Laden consistently stressed the political goals and unity among the Islamists of all hues, including non-Arabs and non-Sunnis. Finally, ISIS is attracting fighters from around the world who have come to regard Syria as the new cause célèbre of global jihadism. This is a novelty as well, going beyond what we saw with Al-Qaeda. Al-Qaeda was more working under a logic of homogenizing and exporting a particular type of jihadi. And the Hamburg cell would be the perfect example as such. In other words, ISIS is focused on a regional center of gravity, coalescing somewhere between Raqqa and Fallujah for primarily regional purposes. Whereas Al-Qaeda rewrote the transnational rule book to fundamentally beam out its political religious fight internationally. The way I see it, the prize for the new group is Damascus and Baghdad. For the old one, it was Washington and New York. And that is a key qualitative difference. Al-Qaeda had turned Louis XIV's dictum, I am the state, l'état c'est moi, on its head, making a de facto statement, la guerre c'est moi, I am war, whereas ISIS tautologically is saying, I want to be a state, the Islamic state. But ISIS is also introducing important innovations, and I think here we definitely have to say a brief word about its use of technology. Really, it's important to get a full sense of this. They're present on all social media platforms. They have a manual for evading geolocation. They have introduced video productions and upgraded them. We're no longer looking at the cell phone uploaded at the time and the YouTube videos of Al-Qaeda or the static VHS tape that Bin Laden used to FedEx to Al Jazeera. We're looking at HD quality, regularly varied videos, serialized, clanking of the swords 4, using Roman numerals, as in Star Wars Episode 4. 50-second trailers, The Flames of War, which is uploaded 24 hours after Obama's speech with a subtitle saying the fighting has just begun. A serialized responsiveness with the beheadings over the summer. An imagery that is very much influenced by Hollywood, literally shades of David Fincher's Seven, Catherine Bigelow's Hurt Locker, Zero Dark Thirty, the super slow motion use. All of this is kind of telling us of a hyper-modern propaganda as such, to scare and attract. Bin Laden used to have speeches. They're showing you battle scenes. Bin Laden never showed battle scenes. This is different as such. Professional use of InDesign, Photoshop, Adobe, Final Cut, all of the things that we're familiar with in our lives, and centralized and decentralized tweeting. They're inviting people to tweet on their own, and documentaries, one of them recently titled The End of Sykes-Picot, references to history, and narrated by a Chilean to give you an indication of how international. I'd like to close by raising a few questions. ISIS, as I said, is introducing innovations, but there's a couple of questions that are up in the air. Is ISIS really expansionist, or is it in fact focused on this new AFPAC, Syriac, shall we say? Is it fully transnational in its makeup, or is it an Iraqi story? Or is it an Iraqi story gone Syrian and back to Iraq? Thirdly, how will the outer rims of radical Islam ultimately relate to this? AQIM in particular in the Sahel and AQAP in the Gulf, which have not clearly come out in relation to this. Al-Qaeda on the Arabian Peninsula makes a bit of an ambiguous statement last summer. And the newcomers, Ansar al-Sharia in Libya and Ansar Bayt al-Maqdis in Egypt. What we see also is the pressure on the groups with secessionist logics, the Junud al-Khilafa in Algeria, kind of going to support that. In closing, ladies and gentlemen, I would say the following. What does reading, in the British sense of the phrase, Al-Qaeda and ISIS tell us in the early 21st century? Beyond the specific stories and trajectories, which are important, I think that the notion of evolution is centrally present in the narrative of Al-Qaeda and therefore of the Dawla al-Islamiyya. Both objectively, they tell stories about themselves, and we have to look at that, but subjectively also when we're looking at groups transforming in a variety of ways that are quite confusing and as they seek to ascertain themselves. Yet understanding these groups seems marred or colored by a paradox. Namely, for all of the talk about both groups, Al-Qaeda for 10 years and ISIS for about 2 years now, or a year and a half, the plethora of commentary, there is a pervasive sense of uncertainty. What is Al-Qaeda, we keep hearing, as we for 10 years? We hear now, what is ISIS? Who is it made of? What does it want? The current cover of The Atlantic has that question as such. Does it even exist? We hear the same questions time and again, and this is no small paradox. That 14 years after Al-Qaeda became a household name in leading the biggest terrorist attack in history, and 25 years after its creation, we are still wrestling with those questions and opening them again as if we have learned nothing of 10 years of battling, or talking at least about Al-Qaeda, let alone the policy issue. Problematically, social sciences, I think, have continued to approach these groups through the lens of either security or media-led discussions. And none of them is satisfying. Striking similarity between the current discourse and the previous one. Finally, in a neo-orientalist way, we continue to link these questions to the specifics of the MENA, when they're really pointing out to the emergence of a new grammar of international relations, a new conflictuality playing out, in which unsettled post-colonial logics are certainly there, but only part of the story. Globalization is at the heart of this. So what kind of program of research can we have, since we have some students here, and hopefully this will be of interest to them as I close? First of all, I see one avenue, which is about the evolution and maturity of transnational dynamics. What ultimately is transnational violence today? From the first Palestinian moment of the 1970s, Black September, to Al-Qaeda, to ISIS, this success of asymmetric warfare, whereby Hezbollah could beat militarily Israel in 2006 and Hamas tied last summer, what does it say to us when such a group like ISIS is probably the greatest level of control ever reached by an armed group historically? Territory, might, and so on, weaponry. Secondly, the nature of statehood in the region, but beyond. The reverse dynamics of groups behaving or seeking to behave like states and acquire their attributes. And in contradistinction, states behaving like militias and losing those other non-violence defined attributes of statehood. So on the one hand, a statization of the armed groups, and on the other hand, a militiaization of the states. These reverse dynamics are quite revealing for us as such. So Al-Qaeda and the Islamic stories may be well-passing stories. That is a possibility. Or they might be a permanent feature of international relations of the new century. If our knowledge and understanding of these matters is a work in progress, then I think we have to come to some sort of understanding with a little bit more nuanced about this. These are the questions, ladies and gentlemen, ideas that I wanted to kindly share with you, and I thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
You've really given us a whole lot to think about and convinced us that we need to keep you here for about 5 years at least to work on this. And if I may, I want to add two dimensions which I'd really love your opinion on. And this is related to your next book, which we're all looking forward to, which is how do you perceive the relationship between what we call Al-Qaeda or ISIS or this sort of phenomenon with authoritarian states, with the shadow forces, and this is this is a very well-known phenomenon from Pakistan to Algeria, passing through the Ba'ath Party and Egypt and all that. So how does it square up, especially the Ba'athist component in ISIS? And this is something that really puzzles me a lot. And the other puzzle I want to add is whether the jihadists of Europe are not a purely European phenomenon, nothing to do with what's happening in the region. You have a society shifting to the right, with a fringe, with a loony fringe, neo-Nazis or whatever, and it's possible that this jihadist phenomenon in Europe is part of that. If you just become Al-Qaeda instead of becoming a neo-Nazi in that sort of thing. So anyway, I don't want to monopolize the whole thing, but these are the two things that I've been really wanting to ask you before, in addition to the very interesting.
Thank you. So these are excellent questions. You may address them immediately. I think the authoritarian aspect is really important. There's two things about it. Conceptually, I think that such groups are a bonanza for the authoritarian state. I mean, we see it today with what Assad is doing very much capitalizing on their presence. If one wants to be conspiratorial, maybe even the fact of opening the jails and letting this happen or planning it is certainly a possibility as such. But it's always a plus because you have the ability to say, look, here's the devil you're fighting, I'm also fighting it. Somehow it builds connections, and we have today certainly a lot of policymakers in the West rethinking their original positions about Assad. A few days ago, a group of French parliamentarians visited Assad, and a few months ago, several officials in this country made statement about maybe rethinking the Assad line. And that's quite paradoxical as such. And it has to do more about, I think, impatience in policy making, a lack of knowledge of these things, and going from 0 to 100 overnight. Turkey did the same mistake, which is particularly problematic because you're looking at a neighboring country as such. The other thing, and that's more now documentary, I think, and thank you for pointing this out because I wanted to raise it, there is clearly an element of the current ISIS which goes back all the way to the Republican Guard of Saddam Hussein. And when you see the ability of these actors to control territory, to take big cities like Mosul, which they hold today, since June 11, it's been almost a year and a half, the second largest city in Iraq, the military planning over two countries, this doesn't happen with a 20-year-old jihadi who has no experience. It has there's a certain military acumen that is needed there, and that is something that is the result of that that story of the military of Saddam Hussein. On the jihadis, the global ones, I agree with you. I think that it's essentially, as I try to make the point, a postmodern story about globalization. Look, it's the new cause célèbre. It could have been anything else. We've seen this in the past, people in the 70s traveling to other places. Today it happens to be the Levant, but what attracts these young men and women is just as much what they're bringing themselves to this. A lot of it is the dissatisfaction, a strong malaise in societies in Europe, the radicalization, discrimination and racism, failed stories of integration, you name it. And so an idealized picture of a future they're going to, which has nothing to do with what they're bringing as such. And so this kind of meeting them halfway, what ISIS does is visibilizing this possibility. The only novelty, as I would say, is that these actors are very much now molding the ISIS story itself. Everything that I said about the media, for instance, is the result of the media head of ISIS, who happens to be a German rapper, Dennis Cuspert is his name. And it's very interesting that you have this element brought into this and transforming the scene's life.
My name is Shahla Alkali. I'm a PhD student here. I'm from Kurdistan region. I born and was raised in Baghdad. My last paper, I had a paper about ISIS. It's called The Iraqization of Al-Qaeda Group and Armed Groups in Syria. And I'm so happy to hear that such a renowned professor is actually agreeing with many of my arguments. And it's kind of a comment and also a question. I would very much be interested to hear your idea about it. In terms of Iraqization of Al-Qaeda and Syrian armed group, I know the ISIS is using the ideology of Al-Qaeda at the very beginning to the process of recruiting. But as a person who lived in Baghdad, I really see how they strategically move among the Iraqi city. And I feel that ISIS is the Iraqi army, whereas the current militias, it's the militiaization of what's the institution in Iraq. And I would be interested to hear what's that impact in terms of restructuring of the whole Middle East, because there is a restructuring process, and it's the first time that the international world superpower are not the only key players for this. It's comment is that ISIS, what's it's more important for them? Is it an Iraqi story? Is it Iraq is the crown jeweler for ISIS, and they're gonna fight there more than even in Syria, and there are so many detailed dynamics toward that I would love to share with you later on. But so linking all this idea, what's the vision, if there is a clear vision for the Middle East and the restructuring process, and giving that ISIS actually represent a political grievances within Iraq, and if you solve it politically, there is a whole another story. So, I mean, there are so many dynamics within ISIS that clearly it's Iraqization of and hijacking of, let's say, of Al-Qaeda. Where does that take us? And giving that having Iranian as a sponsor of many types, different types of militias, you have Saudi Arabia, you have this triangle of the regional power, Turkey, Iran, and Saudi Arabia. Where does that take us? Thank you so much for such an in-depth analysis of the situation.
Shall I? Yes. Thank you. Thank you very much. I agree with a lot of the things you said, and particularly the point about hijacking of Al-Qaeda. There's something quite opportunistic about ISIS as such. It's nothing specific. I mean, terrorist groups move like this. It's a matter of alliances, and then second and third generations tend to be usually more violent, by the way, less political, using the renowned name of the organization. With Al-Qaeda, it's an easy ride because it's been quite a well-known and a successful operation. I mean, bin Laden basically succeeded. What he's saying is that, what he was saying is that should I die, I should become irrelevant to my movement. And the legacy of bin Laden is not Al-Qaeda as an organization, it's Al-Qaedism as a movement and as something, as an open source, essentially, a radicalization process, which is what's happening with ISIS. But I think we also see them doing this over a period of almost 10 years. As I said, as early as October 2006, this Iraqization begins happening. What the first Baghdadi, what the others that follow do is exactly this. And after the surge, 2007 and 8, you have the tribes coming for a moment to ally, go rather against, and then ally themselves last year. So you have a very strong component of Iraq into this. But the key thing that gives us ISIS now is the Syrian story. In effect, let's say ISI, Islamic State in Iraq, could have remained on this kind of one day winning, one year, a good year, bad year, for a few years, but with the situation in Syria, it capitalizes. It sends its troop, and this is maybe the genius of al-Baghdadi, who says, I can use this to reboot my organization. And there's a battle plan around that he does. Particularly in Raqqa, and particularly with the so-called Breaking the Walls campaign, you might know, the breaking of the prisons, it's quite dedicated. What he does is surround himself with military capable thugs, but also people that could plan these operations. That's the novelty that al-Baghdadi introduces as such. It's much more of a ruthless cult operation as such. The point about vision and history, I think these groups usually have little of that. You know, we tend, probably the most elaborate was bin Laden in his 24, 25 speeches that one can read, but it was a reactive message. It was about the presence of the US troop in the Gulf. It was the support to Israel. It was the support to the authoritarian Arab states. That's the narrative. But it's not necessarily with the vision. The Caliphate was only used nominally as such. Today, we have the same phraseology. But I really think that their eye, and I might be wrong on this, but that's my perception of looking at this, that the eye is really the prize, as you said, is very much Baghdad and Damascus, while threatening the West. But they're not necessarily actively pursuing operations in the West. I mean, the Paris support, the recent operation, but they're not necessarily doing that as in day in, day out, trying to control territory, position themselves. And that's that. I would very much, Shahla, agree with the Iraqization of AQ and the Syrianization of it today also as well. Please.
We can
discuss this. Yes.
Thank you so much.
Sure.
Yes, please. We should. Send, we need this for the.
Okay, thank you so much for your really interesting talk. My name is Molly Zapata, and I'm a second-year student, and I'm working on my thesis on AQIM. And I'm interested in your perspective on both ISIS and Al-Qaeda's like connections to groups throughout Africa and other regional groups, because you mentioned in your talk that AQIM and AQAP are a little bit murky on which one they're aligning with, but it's my understanding that Drukdal is pretty solidly on the Al-Qaeda side, but that is a recent like source of contention within that group. And then I know that other groups throughout the region, Boko Haram, Al-Shabaab, you know, groups through Libya and Tunisia have aligned with ISIS. And so I'm wondering what you think that says about the future of Al-Qaeda and of ISIS.
Hi, I'm Jack Berger. I'm a second-year MOD. My question is more specifically about, you mentioned Ansar Bayt al-Maqdis and Ansar Syria in Libya. And I wanted to ask, I know that Ansar Bayt al-Maqdis is now suddenly Sinai State, and that Ansar Syria and Derna have declared themselves also to be affiliates of ISIS. And so given the regional nature of ISIS, I wanted to know what is the significance of those pledges of allegiance and what coordination or collaboration, if any, is occurring or will occur between those groups, again, given ISIS's very regional specific focus.
Hi, my name is Morgan. I'm a second year student here. And I just wanted to thank you again for your time and your insight on this very pertinent topic. My question is specifically related to ISIS. You briefly touched upon technology and the unprecedented use within their propaganda campaigns. And I was wondering if you had an opinion on what regional or Western actors could do in order to effectively respond to these methods of highly disseminated, very public media. Thank you.
Should I take these three?
Yes.
Thank you very much. Thank you for your questions. They're very interesting, and be happy to address them. Molly, on the situation with AQIM, yes, I think for now there is ambiguity. I think Drukdal has always been probably the most opportunistic of the actors in the Al-Qaeda universe as such. I think he probably sees the rise of ISIS with a bit of irritation, given that he had been there before, and he also has worked a lot to develop quite a powerhouse in the Sahel. He probably feels that he survived so far the French presence in the region actively. I mean, they managed to, he and Belmokhtar, Abu Zayd was killed, but so there's a sense of I'm a key player. Why should I surrender to you immediately? And I came into this picture through the affiliation with Al-Qaeda. And in his case, this is probably the most important element. The Salafist Group for Predication and Combat predated that affiliation, as you know. So there's a sense of having a capital that he wants to use and surrendering it to somebody that in effect rose at the same time as him, Baghdadi, within the ranks, is something that he probably is thinking about capitalizing on. The problem that he has is that within his second tier, you have people that have already spoken positively about this. I'm thinking particularly about Mujao, the movement that has gained the offshoot of AQIM. And so I think there's a bit of dissonance in that message as such. I expect Drukdal to stay on that line for the time being, until such time maybe that ISIS becomes really kind of overwhelming in its presence, and then he will have to make a decision. But there's distance. It's a Maghrebi story. It's a North African Sahelian story as such. The real issue for him will come, and I will address this in Jack's question, about from Libya as such. Yes, so I think that's essentially on the other thing that is important is that Baghdadi has made a mistake or displayed a sort of racism which you find sometimes among Arabs and particularly among the groups, the armed groups themselves, towards Africans. He failed to mention the groups in one of his statements a few months ago. He said we have support, and he mentioned essentially the Gulf and North Africa, whereas at that time Boko Haram had already spoken and others. And whether he's indicating that he's really focusing on the region or whether he simply forgot them, I think the message, it was a tactical mistake as such. Boko Haram has grown transnationally. It is now not only a Nigerian story, but Chad, Cameroon, Niger, and the same logic that I was explaining about transnational terrorism. And Boko Haram itself is quite a big powerhouse as such. That's what I would say about this. Connecting this with Jack's question, I do think that the two important new actors are indeed Ansar Bayt al-Maqdis, Ansar al-Sharia, or Ansar al-Sharia Plus, because the groups, they are quite varied, and we have here an expert on Libya who can comment on this. We have a lot of movements there in flux. But the fact that you have a rising ISIS presence in Libya, and another one in Ansar Bayt in the Sinai, seem to me quite important. And if they manage to make a greater imprint, and in Libya they're on their way of doing that. The recent attack on the hotel, not the Concordia, Corinthia. The Corinthia, thank you. That was quite interesting because you're seeing them spreading beyond the city itself that they control, Derna. And as the more they do that, connecting it with your question, the more I think AQIM will feel under pressure that we have here, kind of a shifting of power as such. Let me just qualify what I said earlier. I do believe that ISIS is regionally oriented because of its territorial DNA, but I think they're also modulating their international influence. They're happy to have these people stand up and say and wave the flag of ISIS from Libya to the Gulf to sometimes demonstrations in Europe, for that matter. So this is something that they capitalize on, but for now, I think only in terms of communication. Not necessarily in terms of operations. They're letting the people in Libya take the lead, whereas Al-Qaeda was sending operators, I was saying, as such. On Morgan, on technology, yes, I do think that's really kind of a very important innovation. I think the facts that I mentioned speak for themselves, and it's constantly innovating and getting better and more impactful. One video starts with a drone aerial view. I mean, it's quite impressive. The mindset behind it, for me, is more important. Not just the imagery, but to have somebody plan this, script it, as they would do in Hollywood. Okay, we'll start this with a drone aerial view, and the editing, all of that speaks of an uber-modern entity as such. The response has been quite feeble, and in fact, I think there was an attempt by the State Department to have a tweet kind of battle. They used that to make fun of that. As such, the Syrians had some kind of playing out role playing on their TV about that, and then they also made fun of that. It's kind of always playing catch up. It's very difficult because the medium is really for it's a counter narrative that you can deliver easily, particularly towards states who have bureaucracies and very heavy-handed kind of messages as such. What can be done? Well, this leads us into counter-terrorism issues, and there my quick answer, it's a portfolio. I mean, you need a little bit of societal issues, some policing, sometimes military responses, but it's not an easy way to address that. And communication is quite challenging here.
Hi, I'm Sarah Detzner. I'm a PhD student here at the Fletcher School. My background is in U.S. security issues in particular, so that's the perspective I'm coming at this from. And I wonder, from everything you've said here, if in some ways ISIS is not constrained and thus vulnerable in a way that Al-Qaeda was not, in the sense that because they've set up they've taken the step of proclaiming the caliphate, its transnational potential, despite these couple of pop-ups, is extremely limited because you can't have groups like Shabab or Boko Haram. It's all or nothing. You can't be partners. You have to pledge allegiance. And in some of the ways that Al-Qaeda could be protected by states, which of course was one of its most pernicious qualities, that's also not possible within this system. And a quick follow-up there. That's seeing ISIS prime, you know, in the model, which isn't entirely appropriate, of a transnational group. But seeing ISIS as more of a secessionist insurgency, which again is not perfectly appropriate, even if they lose territorially, they should be able to fade back into the population and keep going. But because they're so dependent on foreign forces, so I guess I'm seeing a couple of levels of brittleness here, and I'm wondering if they could really survive territorial losses?
So thank you, Jean-Louis Romanepeau. I'm a PhD at Fletcher, and I do focus on Libya. I'm going to pick on a couple of your statements to ask you two questions. The first one regards the extent to which you think that the Islamic State is an actual movement with command, control, communication, and a measure of coordination, both locally and globally, with affiliated groups, compared to another dimension, which is instead a global narrative, non-territorialized. So you helped us understand the territorial dimension, but there is also this dialectic between the Islamic State and groups scattered in the region, with other actors in other countries conducting attacks and then claiming affiliation. So I feel like there is a component that is beyond the territorialization of the Islamic State as you portrayed it, and your insistence on the use of the media clearly signifies that there is also an eye on that dimension. And latching to this, the second question is the extent to which, and going to social science, macro, social, political perspectives, the extent to which you think that the Islamic State is the anti-politics, the anti-modern state, and hence the answer to that would be to give room, for instance, to political Islam, which is actually the opposite of what's happening with counterterrorism, and give room to more local governance and the evolution of powers and local administration. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, both of your questions. Sarah, is it? Sarah, thank you. I think the very three points you made are exactly what I have in mind when I spoke of this deceptive rebooting of Al-Qaeda that ISIS is pursuing. In other words, it's using everything that Al-Qaeda did, but it's taking it to another level, as we said. But the ultimate end result is, in fact, full of paradoxes. And these three points, I think, is exactly what I would say. First of all, territorially, the territorialization is quite problematic because it raises question of vulnerability. And it's quite, in fact, useful for any military. Territories where you can be found, territories where you can be pinpointed, territories where you can be defeated. So as opposed to the evanescence of transnationalism per se, or Al-Qaeda as it was trying to do. Secondly, as you rightly say, if you declare a caliphate, which we know is not tenable in the medium and long run, it's not going to happen. It's just phraseology. But although consequential phraseology, you also set yourself for failure at some point, whether it's 2 years or 20 years from now. That is, thirdly, whereas Bin Laden was inviting French ISIS to be born and proliferate and go, they're looking for an actual allegiance, which creates power relations. Our point earlier about Drukdel saying, why should I do this? Who are you to ask me? Weren't you also working just like me 5 minutes ago for Bin Laden? It kind of creates a bit of an ego issue as such. So these three points are, I think, exactly what would be the untenable aspect of it. But you said something important there about transnationality. I think transnationality per se, and this was my invitation to the colleagues here, has to be unpacked fully. What exactly is transnationality beyond the beyond the transcending of borders, which we know is something, beyond the cross-borders dynamics? It takes us, and this is your second question, Jean-Louis, about the very nature of politics today and conflictuality. And I think that is what ISIS is raising, interestingly for us as researchers as such. On your question, Jean-Louis, I do think that they are quite an organized movement. You see clearly the command and control. One of the videos, for instance, is extremely impressive. You see them setting up, you see them going to set up a fake checkpoint with using Iraqi military fatigue, and they're checking people going through and looking at the identities and some official stops or an individual. They produce out of nowhere a laptop and check on their database and take him to the side and shoot him and let others go. This kind of military operation style is extremely indicative of planning. This doesn't happen with your amateurish groups as such. Yet at the same time, I do also believe, and you're right, that there's a strong component, and this is the media discussion, about the narrative, the communication aspect, which is part of today. I would argue that ISIS is a hybrid in the making. It's the logical, it's offspring of Al-Qaeda. If Al-Qaeda was opening the door to globalization and terrorism of the new age, right, they are fully embracing it. And we shouldn't be surprised in a way that 2015, I mean, as you have kind of these dynamics materializing, and you see them playing out beyond the control of ourselves, and I would say even beyond the control of ISIS. I would say ISIS is not in control of what it's doing, ultimately. That is what it's doing, what it's representing. And that's why we have all of these questions. Uncertainty. Is it territorialization? Is it the global? Is it regionalization? Iraqi, Syrian, or all of the above, for that matter. Finally, I like your point about anti-politics and engaging differently. I would say, as I said, the ideological component with ISIS, I think, is thin. I find more of a political discourse in Al-Qaeda, in effect, than what we have. And ultimately, I think the political discourse of ISIS is really about the intervention in 2003, what took place afterwards with Maliki, Iraq, and in Syria.
Thank you. I'll pass it this way, by Ibrahim.
Okay, so for... First, let me thank you. It was fascinating. To shift the topic slightly and take advantage of your presence here and your expertise, can you tell us a little bit about what's going on in your home country? It's Mauritania is a very interesting country, but unfortunately we don't hear much about it. So since we have you here, it's maybe our opportunity to hear it from the horse's mouth.
Usually, fortunately, when you don't hear about the country.
Oh, that's true. That's true.
Hi, I'm Zeynep Bulutgil, assistant professor of comparative politics. So you talk about the Iraqization of ISIS, which makes sense because they control territory in Iraq and Syria. But at the same time, what percentage of the fighters are actually locals from these regions? And I don't know the answers myself, but if it's mostly international, can we really call it the Iraqization of ISIS? And in the long run, I think this is what Sarah was trying to get at as well. The extent to which they can control their territory has to do with their connections with the locals, right? So as soon as, you know, if they're not recruiting from the locals, as soon as there's some shift of balance of power, there might be other sort of military organizations that resist them. So that's something I'm interested in. And then can you say a bit about the economic, the financial flows to these organizations and whether the flow to ISIS is different from Al-Qaeda?
Professor, thank you so much. Amir Naik, second year student here. I study state legitimacy. And I was really struck by how you put up the idea of ISIS as an aspirational state. So extrapolating into the future, they have this tactical advantage at the aspects of the state that have to do with violence. But especially if they're bound to territory, there's another entire set of obligations that comes with that. And, you know, how do you see that playing out? How is ISIS going to be approaching? Successful seems a stretch, but how are they going to be approaching the non-violence-centric aspects of state functionality?
Thank you. Ibrahim, I'll be happy to discuss this with you. Bilaterally, country is going through its transition. It's, of course, both facing the North African and the Sahelian issues. In terms of security, Al-Qaeda, AQIM in particular, had been a big threat in the mid-2000s. It's a couple of operations that were pursued in the 2010-2011 period. It wasn't involved with the French intervention, but I think that what we're witnessing now is essentially a question of transition, opposition versus the government, the economic challenges. Nothing spectacular, as you said, it's not much in the news. It's one of the blessings of the country to be the unknown Arab country. But I'm happy to discuss this bilaterally since our topic of the day is that issue. Zainab, I think you bring us back interestingly to this question of Iraqization because it has several layers. I do believe, as we were talking earlier, that there is a strong component about Iraq per se. I mean, in effect, if you strip out the 2003 intervention, shall we say, first of all, you wouldn't even have AQI, you wouldn't even have ISIS. And that's an important element, which is a documentary historical fact. But at the same time, I think we've said enough things, all of us today, to see that there's a dimension beyond the Iraqi aspect. First of all, the Syrian aspect of it, just on the other side, which we don't have precise numbers, and it's probably not a 50-50, but at least 30-60 or something like this.
What is the 30-60? Well, yeah.
Good. On the numbers, it's an important question. And first of all, how can official statistics go from 10,000 one day to 30,000 the next day, which is what we had in September? I have a theory on that, by the way. I think that the realistic numbers are somewhere around, let's say, 14, 15,000. I think as a total ISIS, but I think the CIA at the time probably came to that adjustment when the tribes component got in the picture and allowed the control, the journey onto Baghdad, which was never completed. And I think probably counting all of the tribes that supported that movement got you to 30,000. But are they necessarily ISIS in the long term or even then? I doubt that. I think there are more alliances that shift. I would think that you have a group of about 14, 15,000. Out of it, a good 8 to 9 are I think in Iraq. That's what it is fundamentally.
And
from Iraq, mostly in and around all of these actors. Nadim, you had a point to add?
Well, no. Is this including the foreign?
No, the foreign fighters. I was getting to that, and I think the rest would be in Syria with the different groups plus the foreign fighters. I'd rather err on the conservative side than blowing up the numbers, because we had the same issue in the 2000s with Al-Qaeda, by the way. At some point, you had some very nice books published that gave you numbers in 20, 30,000 as such, when I think realistically what took place in the late 80s and early 90s, it was more like 5, 7,000 at best, the type of people we saw training in the camps and running on horseback and all of that as such. So that's key. On the economic side, I think there's two moments. I think the and maybe here Brahim, who's been looking at this, can tell us more about this. I think that we have a first moment of individual sponsoring, mostly from the Gulf, people that have their own radical views to support and a kind of a transfer and substantial amounts, of course, and that certainly probably took place. But I do think that after the past summer, we're looking at something different. We're looking at this on an industrial scale, taking cities, taking control of cities where you have banks, territory, traffic routes, being able to levy taxes, passages taxes, the political economy that comes out of that, the oil wells and the black market that comes out of that, and the agricultural aspects of this wheat and whatnot. I think all of this makes ISIS less, if not completely, not in need of those types of individual support. And I think this is where we are. And that's why they can speak of having their own currency. Again, laughable, but consequentially laughable, because they have sessions in which they explain what the currency is going to be about. Which takes me to the question of the gentleman there about state legitimacy. Look, I think it's a narrative that they're improvising. What we need to find out is what happens between April of last year, when you have Islamic State, Fil Iraq wa Sham, right? And then June 29th, where you have the Khalifat. What you have is Mosul. Taking Mosul changes everything. You know, within 4 days, they take the second largest city in Iraq, and that success has to be managed. I mean, it's kind of, it's completely, it can confuse people. I mean, Lenin has a statement about that after coming from the underground and all of a sudden finding yourself after the revolution in control. It's dizzying, is what he says. It's Schwindelt, you know. So you have this sense of the groups realizing that, well, we have to manage this. We have to capitalize on this. And then, so you go into this logic. And then it kind of has a formant looking momentum. You make an excellent point about going beyond the nonviolence aspect of the state. I think that's their limit, because they're eminently about violence. And because the local population will not, in the long run, be an enabling environment, as we call it in terrorology. That's the enabling environment that helps. You're not going to have, I think, that. The tribes will go against them sooner or later. And it's a logic of obligation as such. The way I see it is a simmering low-level statehood project that for, at best, a number of years, you have the major states unable to retake the territory, including the regional ones, Iraq, Syria, and you have kind of this normalization of a degenerated scene because you're not going to get recognition, you're not going to get international alliances. It's not even like the Taliban's, who were mostly kind of a radical Afghan movement as such.
Yes. Okay, please. And then.
Hi, my name is Annie. I'm a first-year student here. My question is, and this sort of relates to what Amaya has said about aspirational statehood, is one of the things that the media talks about a lot about them is the fact that they're ultra-violent. They sort of revel in these very gory, very public executions. And a few weeks ago, when they had burned the Jordanian and they sparked that very strong reaction from Jordan, I cynically said that, you know, what we really want them to do is to execute a person from every single country in the world, and that way you know everybody kind of turns against them and takes action against them. So this very violent, these tactics that they're using, do you think that's going to eventually backfire on them, and that they're going to have to be forced to modify that, or do you think the publicity and the sort of the infamous, whatever, you know, the attention that they're getting, or is that still going to be enough that they're going to continue those tactics?
Hi, I'm Fahad. I'm a first-year business student here at Fletcher. I totally understand the point that you were making earlier, that it started in Afghanistan and possibly Pakistan, and the ISI really helped up the radical Islam movement at that time. And one point that I want your thoughts about is this is not the first time that Islamic Caliphate is being said. You know, there was the Taliban and they had the Islamic Caliphate for, I think, 5-6 years. And they were pretty much legitimized by a lot of Islamic countries. So they have that model in there. And I want your opinion on the relationship between Taliban and ISIS right now. And secondly, one question that's like always like bothered me is that even if we say that ISIS is going to be defeated tomorrow, radical Islam might take another, you know, player. You know, we see these players propping up every now and then. So do you think defeating an individual organization like ISIS is the answer to radicalization or like fundamentalism? Or does it go beyond that? I mean, I know that they recruit people because they're marginalized and they come from different economic backgrounds or, you know, whatever, but what's the answer to, you know, this?
If I may mm-hmm. add one thing to what Fahad was saying. What about the well-established Islamist movements who also call for, like Harkat Tawhid,
yes.
Who was born in Londonistan, where mm-hmm. mm-hmm. a lot of and the Ikhwan and all that. So they don't seem to be part of the ISIS phenomenon, mm-hmm. whereas ISIS seems to include things that are so incompatible mm-hmm. with it, like mm-hmm. the Baathis, the Naqshbandis, yeah. mm-hmm. and yeah. the tribes. And ISIS seems to be calling for to be attacked.
Yes.
It doesn't want to be loved.
Yes.
I mean, another cynical position would be that to what Annie said, that they might have set a trap to mm-hmm. Jordan mm-hmm. to attack it mm-hmm. because once Jordan attacks it cannot stop.
Yes.
On, so
yes. And in fact, on Jordan, you might think that the reaction and the personalized reaction by the king himself, being pictured in battle fatigue and going for that, might possibly actually open the door to further attacks on Jordan, because that's precisely what the group looks for. And personalized enmities of that nature, certainly, so one has to modulate that. I think that this whole, your question even actually indicated how trapped we are in this phraseology of defeating, you know. Probably the genius of the Bush administration was to use this term of the war on terror, whereas the response to 9/11 could have been something different. You know, fighting terrorism is completely legitimate and people want a security environment, but the manner in which you go about addressing such type of challenges becomes kind of a, it feeds back into the management of it. And this is what we are 15 years into this, the kind of a defeating logic which has taken control of social sciences. That's my point earlier. That it's a policy issue or a journalistic one, that's the prerogative of these two fields. That's a matter of personal judgment. What I think we should be concerned in terms of the scientific aspect of it is how to actually humbly try to understand things in flux before us. A big box about transnationality, what is that? Irrespective of the armed groups. A big box about political Islam, per se, including the democratic political Islam, the ones that agrees to play by the rule. A big box about transitioning spaces. All of those things that are, and of course, the aftermath of conflict. That's what I think we should play with to understand one player, which in this case cuts across all of these in innovative ways, building on what another organization, AQ, did, and as I submit to you, improvising as they go. As such. So all of this is this magma, I think, which is a very interesting, actually, it's very, very thrilling to at this time to work and research on these things, has to be approached without necessarily having kind of a very teleological approach, because that's not science. You know, you don't go into the lab, you know, with all of these elements with your conclusion already. And that's a different approach. So that's my point about that in terms of the ultra-violence that is definitely there. Although, again, we find Al-Zarqawi beheading Nicholas Berg and all of that in 2005 already. And Iraq itself has a very long history of violence, which goes back centuries, including the Ba'azith. Before, I mean, the end of the monarchy in 58, look at the details, they're pretty gory, what happens to a number of people there, and so on and so forth. The 1920s conflict with the British, and all of that takes us into this context of looking at this. On the Khalifat, listening to you, a very good book that came out recently comes to mind, which I recommend to you, Raza Pankhurst, The Inevitable Khalifate, which gives a very good story of the story of the evolution of the Khalifat since over the past couple of decades as such. So that's what I would say if I had on these questions. On the Taliban and ISIS, I think it's still a bit undecided. Again, just as we were saying a little bit, what one has to remember is that Taliban, even with Al-Qaeda, with whom they had an alliance formally, never completely went. And in fact, about 2-3 years ago, the Taliban sent a letter to the U.S. Congress saying that they had nothing to do with 9/11. They claimed that back in October 2001, but the fact that 10 years later they're still insisting points out to the limits of an organization that is local, territorial, and with whatever its radicalization, and these movements that happen to be as such. Nadim, your question is very important. We shouldn't mix apples and oranges when it comes to political Islam, up to including radicalization. I think there is a big narrative about the contemporary nature of political Islam, how it's led to the Arab Spring, how it's used the Arab Spring, and how it's actually paying the price of the Morsi management, and how it's becoming now the preferred target of the Sisis of this world as such. And I think that is a narrative that is a particular trajectory. And I think one has to insist here that these are political movements, that are not necessarily that may or may not use violence, and that has to be looked upon directly, but they're not necessarily synonymous with radicalized movements that, as you said, invite by their own choice that confrontational aspects as such. You said also something very important. I think ISIS is undeniably a hybrid. It has a bit of Al-Qaeda, it has a bit of Iraq, it has a bit of Syria, it had a bit of the foreign fighters, and it has a lot of the military post-Ba'athist kind of legacy, which gives it its might, as far as I'm concerned.
Thank you. I'm sure we can continue for much longer time, but we have to stop now, and if you have a little bit more time before your next appointment, maybe we can informally mingle with some of the students and the faculty. So thank you very much for coming and for such an illuminating speech.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Nadim. Thank you. Thank you very much. Merci. Merci.